God, say amen. Say amen again. God is good. All the time the Lord is good. Can you say amen? If you look around the church, you see the hoppers and rockers t-shirts. Can you say amen? Amen. Well, thank you for our senior citizens ministry. Amen. And they're doing a marvelous job. Amen. Amen. Traveling all over. I love to go with them sometime. I've been missing a trip. I've been trying to catch that one down to that catfish house. But I haven't caught up with them yet. Amen. But thank God for being socially mobile in life. Can you say amen? Amen. Life is to be lived and not all in your backyard. Come on, say amen. Now, the world is it's a big, beautiful world. Amen. People ought to experience it on various levels. Can you say amen? Amen. I want to look at a particular passage of scripture. I want to thank Summer Camp for just being gracious to me. Amen. No one has to do anything for you. Can you say amen? Amen. But when they do it, you ought to say thank you. And let me say to Summer Camp, thank you. They did a marvelous job this year. Can you say amen? Amen. We missed out on most of our Sunday school on Wednesday night. Part of the design for what we do as a church is to always be reaching out. Let me just drop a footnote, a hint to you about believers. Believers can be selfish. I said believers. Those who claim the cross, been washed in the blood and filled with the Holy Spirit, can be extremely selfish. They can think about themselves and not the good of others. And we can woo and war about the woes of the world, but we won't get our hands dirty. We won't get involved. Spirituality can be messy. Come on, say amen. When you're really trying to help people, it can cost you something. I mean, you're truly trying to help. I ain't talking about fronting now. I'm talking about helping people. It can cost you something. And when you want to live for Jesus, you got to be a soldier of the cross. Come on, say amen. Everybody is not a soldier. And sometimes when a gun is fired, some soldiers will run. Come on, say amen. What I'm trying to say to you is when we have an opportunity to touch others, you ought to be the first in line. Let me say it again. What does Jesus mean to you? What did he do for you when you got saved? When we have an opportunity to touch others, you ought not say, well, count me out. You ought to be the first in line. Come on, say amen. That you can touch somebody's life. Can you say amen? God is good all the time. So the next time we have a summer camp program, I'm expecting, if you hear from the heart of your pastor, you're following your pastor. Everybody don't follow the pastor. Dr. Rudolph W. McKissick Jr. Senior taught me that. Everybody don't follow the pastor. But those who follow their pastor, when we do outreach, and all you have to do is come and sit, you ought to show up. Come on, say amen. You know, you're not developing a Roman road or St. John road or 1 John road to Christ. All you're doing is saying, I believe in Jesus. Wave your hand and stomp your feet. Somebody might get saved. Can you say amen? You ought to be willing to do that if you've been blood washed at the cross of Calvary. Amen. Now, if you're not saved, I understand. Amen. Because you just don't know what it means to be saved, for God to bring you out. Amen. I'm not on my way to heaven by myself. God forbid I go to heaven by myself. I'm on my way to heaven with everybody I can take with me. Come on, say amen. Everybody, amen. And so we ought to be concerned. We are a church that believes in total church evangelism. Touch your neighbor, that's just a little philosophy. Total church evangelism. We don't do nothing that eclipses us from reaching out to people. Nothing. Come on, say amen. Amen. We believe in that in every way, amen. So you just want to know my philosophy, my biblical philosophy. Everything is to reach out to others. Jesus says, I must go through Samaria. It was a divine must, because he had an appointment to meet somebody there who life had been broken for years. And all he wanted to say to her is, you just don't know what it means to receive the eternal water of life. Amen? Amen. So we're about reaching out to others. Can you say amen? Amen. Nobody should beat the church in reaching out. Nobody. Nobody. Amen? Amen. When you're so caught up in yourself, you can't help nobody. And believers, I said those who are saved, it's just been my experience, can be selfish. Amen? We don't want to be that way. We want to be transforming. We want to be the light of the world, the salt of the world, all the things that Jesus has prescribed to believers as being an influence on the planet. I'm talking Bible to you if you read it. That is what we ought to be about. Amen? And listen to me. Listen to me very well. It really don't take that much to let somebody know you care. I said, don't take that much. Just a handshake, a smile, a phone call, a text, stuff we do every day, but we do it often in our own interests, never considering where somebody else may be. I wish I had a Holy Ghost with us. Amen. So I want to say that because I thought Wednesday night we did not have the proper representation of this church. And, you know, as I lead forward, you know, I'm not here to survive. I'm not here to survive. I could be other places surviving. No. Matter of fact, you ought to not be anywhere trying to survive unless it's an absolute necessity of life. You understand me? Let me break it down a little further. That's all you can do for now. For now. But later, be like James Brown. Get up off of your thing. And shake it till you feel better. That's just a little stick for you to, you know, so you know what I'm talking about. And we ain't in the business of surviving. Those days are over. We're in the business of thriving, but you can't do it unless you order your life. That is Genesis chapter 1. You will forever live in void and darkness unless you bring order to your life. Are you with me here? I'm just giving you a little philosophy for living in life. Amen. Order brings out the best in you. And that's what God did in chapter 1. Read it again for yourself. Amen. Throw a little light on something and everything will turn out better. Amen. Amen. So that's what we want to do. That's what we want to be about. Amen. Creatures that believe in moving forward. Amen. Not just talking about what's on your body, your outside assets, amen, what you can leave behind for your children. Come on, say amen. Amen. Y'all may not be soldiering up this way. That's the way I soldier. We are not about doing nothing or surviving. We're about thriving. Touch your neighbor and say, I'm thriving. Amen. That's what it's about. Not another pair of shoes. That ain't what I'm talking about now. We simply do not want to just sell ourselves short. I'm just being a little long, but I'm going to say it like I ought to say it. You don't want to sell yourself short. No way we need to sell ourselves short. We're here to make a move for Jesus, to reach thousands for Christ. The question is, are you with me? I say it like Kurt Franklin, GP, are you with me? That's the question. You know, usually people don't want to move forward because it's a matter of self-esteem. I ain't got time, but I could break it down for you. You know, the bigger you see yourself as, or the bigger you think of yourself, the more bigger game you go hunt. That's why the key ingredients to helping children move forward is just confidence. Just tell them they can do it. Boy, you couldn't pay for this. I'm trying to give it to you free. Look at your kid. I don't care where they are in life. Just say, you can do it. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. How do I know they can do it? 95% of children all around the world do not have any educational disorders. 3%, 2% of children have educational disorders, and 3% have incapacity to learn. So you can look at them and tell them. You wonder where I got that from. But you can do it. And I'm looking at you, church, and I'm trying to tell you, we can do it. That's all I'm saying. Every time I come to this pulpit, I say, we can do it. 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 Somebody saying we can't right now. The devil is a liar. And usually he works on people who have low self-esteem or poor self-image. That's the only one right now who's saying we can't. Your image and your esteem about where you can reach in life is telling you, no, we can't do that. But what you really mean is you can't do it. Now you gotta look, you gotta get a right image of yourself. Don't be so high. Don't be too low. You just want to be balanced. And say like Paul, I can do all things. I said, I can do all things. I said, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. And folk think you're arrogant and all that. No, no, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. It ain't, I'm not trying to be big. I ain't trying to be bad. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And we'll get into that strengthen, but I'm not going to leave that alone. Amen. Look at Jeremiah 18. Turn me up just a little bit. My voice, I'm kind of, you know, I didn't get as much sleep as I want to get. Amen. Amen. But sometimes you don't get all your sleep. Your voice goes first. Amen. That's just a footnote. Amen. Jeremiah chapter 18. You're working on me right too. I want to read the first unit of thought, verses 1 through 10. It's Jeremiah 18, prophet Jeremiah. It's the fiery prophet. He's also known as the weeping prophet. What we would call a pictorial prophet. Prophet who demonstrates his prophecy. He prophesied, he also demonstrated the kind of prophecy that he predicted. Amen. And if you read him, you'll know that that is so. Amen. I want to start in verse 1. Are you there? If you're not, say wait. I heard 1 or 2. Jeremiah was called literally from his mother's womb. He's a one of the stronger voices among prophecy. We see him as a major prophet. Amen. And scholars say during his ministry, he did not have one convert. And he wanted to quit. You know the story. And he went up and shut himself up in the room. But he couldn't shut God out. Have I got somebody? And the Bible says there were fire shot up in his bones. And you say amen. I'm gonna call the preacher something else. Verse 1. Pray for me if you will. The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, rise, go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was making something at the wheel. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in his hands of the potter. So he made it again into another vessel, as it seemed good to the potter to make. Then the word of the Lord came to me saying, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter, says the Lord look as the clay is in the potter's hand, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. The instant I speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom, to pluck it up, to pull down, this is Jeremiah's ministry, to destroy, if that nation against whom I have spoken turns from its evil, I will relent. An old King James word says, repent of the disaster that I thought to bring upon it. And the instant I speak concerning a nation and concerning a kingdom, to build it and to plant it, if it does evil in my sight, notice it's in God's sight, so that it does not obey my voice, then I will repent concerning the good which I said I would benefit it. Can you say amen? You may be seated. Father, we come knowing that you are the potter. We are the clay. Mold us. Make us after your will, while we're yielded and still. Lord, would you give the clarion call to those who are parched and withered in heart, broken and bruised in life, felt like they have broken down on the highway of life and can't go any farther. Would you speak clearly a word to their hearts, that there is power in your word, and that they can live again, they can move forward in life. You can repair that which is broken. You can remove the scars, and you can restore them to their original self. Thank you for the power to remake us and to reclaim us, no matter where we've taken ourselves because of ourselves. But in spite of ourselves, you can work. And would you work on us today? For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Can you say amen? I want to talk about the potter's house. The potter's house. Simply, the potter's house. That's how the text is tailored. Potter's house is a familiar and graphic illustration of the working of God in the life of believers. It is ancient language couched in simplicity to tell us how God can work in our lives. The potter's house is where Jeremiah is instructed to go, and many people are in the potter's house, but they are not on the potter's wheel. Too many believers display what could be simply called religious conformity and not the transforming relationship that comes with knowing Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and Lord. For the illustration that Jeremiah gives says that God is constantly working on us. But too many of us have not gotten on the potter's wheel. We are simply in the potter's house. This ninth sermon of Jeremiah, the parable of the potter, is an earthly illustration to give us some spiritual truth or some heavenly implication of how God is dealing with humanity in all of its flaws, all of its mistakes. Wherever you may find yourself in life, this illustrates how God can deal with you. It also tells us of the amazing grace of God. And no matter how we have walked away from God, no matter how far we have fallen, how God can extend his grace to pick us up and remake us. It tells us of the infinite power of God to conform the clay into his purpose, as well as his plan. There are lessons to be learned, and Jeremiah is sent
to the potter's house. So let's go down to the potter's house and see what Jeremiah can learn and what you and I can learn in the potter's house. The first lesson God says when we get to the potter's house, he says in verse 2, he will make us listen to his word. Jeremiah is instructed to go to the potter's house. He leaves the temple ground of what scholars may believe is the high ground in Jerusalem. And the text says he goes down to the potter's house. Some believe that the potter's house was in the valley of Hinnom. The potter's house was a familiar address. The place where God works is a familiar address. All of Israel knew that God was working, but yet they were absent from God's work in their life. And too many of us are here in the church, but absent from how God is working or from the working hand of God in our lives. We are here in the church, but our ears are absent. We don't demonstrate that we are hearing God's word. What results from Jeremiah hearing God's word is he understood how God would be working in our lives. When you are hearing God's word, you can then see God work in your life. You can then understand God's word and God's will more clearly for your life. Israel's problem is they were not listening to God. They had become so distant and out of place with God. Sometimes you can be in God's house and you can become distant and out of place with God. Have I got a witness here? They were listening to idols. When you listen to idols, whatever idol you are listening to or whatever idol you worship, you're going to get on that idol's wheel. That idol becomes the potter. And you become the clay on that idol's wheel. Whatever you worship, that's the wheel you on. If you worship clandestine relationships, you're on that wheel right now. If you worship winning the lottery, you're on that wheel right now. If you worship trying to impress folk, you're on that wheel right now. If you worship your children, you're on that wheel right now. Whatever you worship is spinning your life right now. Jeremiah says, go down to the potter's. Jeremiah is told to go down to the potter's house and see how the potter works. It's important for Jeremiah to listen and to look. It's important for you to listen and to look and understand how God can work in your life. We should listen as if our lives depended upon it. Many of us are between blessing and bombing out. We're between the sweet nectar and nothing. We're between ruin and reward. We're between being a vessel of honor of God on the shelf or being thrown to the heap of dung in life. It just depends on whether or not we're willing to hear God's word. God says he will repent, which is a human concept because God does not change. But God is willing to regulate his dealing toward you and me if we're willing to surrender to him. Problem is, too many believers live unsurrendered lives. We do what we want to do. We do it until Sunday comes around. Have I got a witness here? Then when Sunday comes around, we put on religious conformity. We can say hallelujah, but we know we're raising hell at home. We can do all those things that seem to say that yes, we love the Lord, but really in reality, when the blinds are closed and nobody is looking, we're living our own way and God has no direction or control over our lives. But if we surrender, that's the message in Jeremiah, if we surrender, God can do a work in our lives. Here is the next lesson. God will make us over from ruin if we surrender our lives. Touch your neighbor, says, if you mess it up, God can make it over. Yes, he can. This passage gives us both divine sovereignty and human responsibility. Divine sovereignty tells us that God has a right to do anything with our lives. Bible says in verse 4, the vessel was marred. And even though it was marred, the Bible says he made another out of it. Which says to all of us, God can give us another chance. Not a second chance. I said another chance. Because too many of us have already used up a second chance. And a third chance. And a fourth chance. But God can give us another chance. And he can make something out of our lives. It tells us of our responsibility to God. God says to Israel, upon repentance, God can reward them as a nation and make them into a vessel of honor. God says that to you and I. If we would just surrender. I know you messed up, but surrender. I know you're wrong, but surrender. You've been caught, just surrender. Throw your hands up. Let the Lord arrest your life. Let him take control of you and guide you in the right place. If you just surrender, God can do something with your life that you've never seen before. Just throw your hands up. Say, Lord, I give up. I'm tired of running. I'm tired of doing my own thing. I'm tired of living my own way. Just. Jeremiah observes a potter on the wheel, throwing and tossing the clay. Bible says the clay is marred. It's corrupt. It's really, in the Hebrew, it's been ruined. That word speaks of the evidence of the clay. The text says it was marred in the hands of the potter. It's not because of the skillful hands of the potter. It was marred in and of the clay itself. Bible says you were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. The Bible says you got a proclivity to do the wrong thing. Paul says, when I desire to do good, evil is always present. Have I got a witness here? See, it's something in us that leads us down the wrong road. And we need a God to remake us and to remold us. Have I got a witness here? The makeover that God does by implication of this text is from nothing. That's what God says. God says, I can take your nothing. You mess it up. You marred it. You ruined it. It's corrupt. It was something you did. You were doing your own thing. But God says, because you were doing your own thing, and even though you were doing your own thing, I can take your thing. Isn't that something? God can take your thing and turn it into his thing and make it something of honor. Have I got a witness here? That ought to be good news for some folk in here. Because everybody don't know your story. They really don't know what kind of person you really are. But God says, I don't care how messed up you are. God can take your mess, yes sir, and make a masterpiece out of it. Somebody ought to be shouting right there. Because somebody would pull your script right now. You'd be ashamed for them to know you really are like that. But the Lord says, out of nothing, I can make something out of it. Just give me nothing, and I'll do it again. Didn't he do it in the beginning? Stepped out on nothing and hung something down, told it to stay there. Just give the Lord nothing, he can make something out of it. It was marred, but he turned it into a masterpiece. It was corrupt, but he reconstructed it. Somebody can witness right there. I was messed up, doing my own thing, thought I was having fun, but the Lord laid his hands on me. Have I got somebody? I really can't tell you how he did it. All I know is he laid his hands on me. And since he touched me, nothing has been the same. Is there anybody in this business building God has touched and changed their lives? He takes that which is destroyed and make something dynamic out of it. Just as he did in the beginning. He took dust. That's all you are. Huh? With that good fine perfume on. Expensive makeup on. Them good shoes on your feet. just dust. 18, 14 karat gold, just dust. Don't care what you got on, how you dressed up, you just. But look what God did with dust. He can make some out of you. You know, when you really go down to where the potter makes vessels out of clay, there are vessels that have tags on them that are right on the shelf within your reach. They are called vases. But if you go up higher, you got your vases. Have I got a witness here? You see, God doesn't have to make you a vase. He can make you a vase. Have I got somebody? And see, when you look at a vase, it ain't got a tag on it. Have I got somebody? Because God can make you priceless. Yes, he can. He can take something that's nothing and make it priceless. Folk can say you were born on the wrong side of the track, but you're priceless. They can say you didn't get the right education, but now God has made you priceless. Mud, he can make it over again. It means God can turn you away from your worst state into something you've never been before. Somebody might have walked in here today and said, man, I can't believe I done that. I can't believe I've fallen that low. But God can take you at your lowest state and turn you into something you've never been before. I gotta say that with a little joy, because I've been down before. But he picked me up, turned me around, placed my feet. I'm witnessing for myself on solid ground. Yes! Listen. He doesn't have to, listen, return you back to the point of innocence. He can take you from where you are and make you more innocent than you ever been. He takes that which is broken and rebuilds it. You know what I discovered? A lot of times we're broken in life. Some of us been broken at an early age in life. Some of us were violated at an early age in life. And some of us been broken by people who we really trust. But I don't care how you've been broken, God can rebuild your life. He takes that which is ruined. We did it to ourselves. Here come God. He can rescue us. He can recall us. He can restore us. He can recover us. He can return us. Though broken and marred, it can still be used. Though your life has been messed up, God can still use you. Don't let nobody tell you God can't use you. He can use you anywhere, anytime, and anyhow. Don't care who you are, how old you are, how young you are, God can use you. Mold you into what he wants you to be as it seemed good in his sight. The third lesson says, God says, he wants to use you in his hands. Did you notice the hands of God? Not just a potter, but at the wheel, but his hands on the vessel. You all leave out of here saying, Lord, lay your hands. Lay your hands on me. Whatever you do, just lay your hands on me. God wants to put his hands on you. Have I got a witness here? The book says he can make us into something good. Isn't that great? That when God begins to work on you, he makes you into something. That word make has a broad sense. It means that God can fashion, he can furnish, he can fix, he can fulfill your life. God can govern, he can grant, he can bring the greatness out of you. It means he can keep you, he can make you, he can meet your every need. It means he can perform, prepare, procure, or provide for you. God can do something with your life. That means everybody in this building, no matter what you've done, no matter where you are, if you just let him lay his hand, have I got somebody on you? He can begin to make you into what he wants you to be. He works, you just yield. He'll use you. Four elements of the text and I'm through. There are four elements that dominate this text, that literally dominate the way God works in our lives. The first obvious element is Jeremiah. Preacher, go down to the potter's house and I'll give you a word there. But notice, God gave him a word. Then he gave a word to the people. That's how God works. God to the prophet gave him a pictorial illustration of how God works in a heavenly way, in an earthly manner. Then after God gave him a word there, he gave that same word to the people. Many of our problems start with the preacher. Have I got somebody? Because you're not listening to the word of God. It's not the word of man, it's the word of God. And if God is going to work on your life, you got to hear his word. Preacher said, thus said the Lord. He speaks the terms of dealing with God and God dealing with us. We know from reading the text further that Israel, where Israel was, that Israel had made mistakes. Israel had messed up. Jeremiah probably was frustrated in his ministry. God sent him down to the potter's house to show that even though you messed up, even though you're ruined, even though you're corrupt, even though you decay, what I can do. So Jeremiah needs to realize what God can do. Every preacher preaching to people needs to understand what God can do. The one thing I know God can do, he can save. Have I got somebody? Don't care how corrupt you are. Don't care how messed up you are. Don't care how far you are falling. God can save. Clay is the second element. We are nothing outside the hands of God. Just a lump of nothing. No shape. No form. Till God places his hands on us. We're marred at our best self. But the clay says, I'm ruined. The potter says, get on the wheel. The clay says, I've gone too far. The potter says, not too far from me. The clay says, you can't see. I've never been nothing. But the potter says, I can turn nothing into something. No matter what you say about yourself, God says, I've seen the worst in you. That's right. God seen us at our worst. But it didn't matter. He still wants to do something with our lives. Messages with the prophet as to what God can do. And he constantly mediates the prophet that is between the clay and the potter. The third is the potter, which is God. God takes wet clay and he remakes it. It doesn't matter how marred it may become. The people of Judah responded to God and said, we are helpless to change. It's just no use, God. God says that's every use. And he was trying to put it in his preacher, but he also was trying to tell us, Jeremiah says, he says to Jeremiah, watch the pot. No matter how messed up the clay is, he can take messed up clay and remake it. And what God was trying to say to Jeremiah, no matter how messed up people are, if they surrender and put themselves in my hand, I can remake their lives. Jeremiah went down to the potter's house to say to Israel, you've not gone too far. Maybe God is saying to somebody in this room, you've not gone too far. You coming to church just because mama said, or you came to church just because some friend said. But you really know how messed up you've been. What kind of actor you are. God says you have not gone too far. Not too far for me to save you. Not too far for me to lift you up. Not too far for me to bring you back. You have not gone too far. Don't care how you messed up. Don't care what you done. God says, I'm willing to remake your life. You need to surrender to God today. Don't walk out here trying to decide it for yourself. I'm going to do it my way because I messed up. No, baby. We all have messed up. Stop right there. God can do something with your mess up that you've never seen before. Finally, the text really says, it says, let me put my hands on you. I dare you to let him touch you. I said, I dare you to let God touch you. Let God put his hands on you. I'm talking about surrendering. I'm talking about you say yes to your will. Yes to your way. Let God lay his hands on you right now. I'm talking about you being sold out for Jesus. Right now, just let him lay his hands on you. I don't care how bad of a rascal you've been. I don't care if you've been a baller or shot caller. Let God lay his hands on you. And when God put his hands on you, I don't care how messed up you used to be, God can change your mess up and turn it into something else. Because the story really is trying to tell us that God can show us how we can be before people. Everybody might be able to see your scars. It doesn't matter what you used to be. Honey, what you used to be don't matter to God. God is taking you in a new direction. He's about to do something new in your life. Just let him lay his hands on you. Touch your neighbor and say, let God lay his hands on you. When God get his hands on you, he can make a difference in your life. I'm a witness, child of God. He laid his hands on me. When the Lord laid his hands on me, he made a difference in my life. I'm glad I'm saved. Yes, I am. Jesus saved me one day. He picked me up, turned me around, placed my feet on solid ground. Yes, I'm happy because I know the King. Yes, I'm glad he saved me. Let him lay his hands on you. Yes, yes.
Stars. that God bless the broken road that led me straight to you. Let me straight to you.